I'd like to introduce to you former fellow Texan, Saul Wisenberg. Saul used to prosecute down in San Antonio these kinds of financial fraud claims that we're talking about, and now he does white-collar criminal defense. He practices in Washington, D.C., and lives in Baltimore, and so let's welcome Saul Wisenberg.
Thanks, Rafe. I think I'm going to head to the podium. And Professor Black told me I could talk about anything I wanted to. And when I usually talk about it at his gatherings, he said, talk about how you actually, how you prosecuted these people. And then maybe we can talk later about, and I'm happy to answer any questions and feel free to interrupt. Maybe we can talk about why it's not happening now, which is Rafe's topic. And
I think that's a great idea.
Here are the kind of basics. I put them on the board. I'll talk a little bit about them. I'm basically going to tell war stories to illustrate these points. What you need is prosecutors, and it's mostly line prosecutors. In the savings and loan era, I don't know if you've seen the statistics, but it was an incredibly vigorous prosecutorial effort, and it was overwhelmingly carried out by line prosecutors in U.S. attorney's offices throughout the country, primarily in Texas. And so you need to be fearless, you need to be free of political influence, you need to have sufficient resources, you need to improvise when you don't have sufficient resources, you need to be willing to lose. That's probably the most important thing. You need to be willing to win ugly. We'll talk about what that means. You need to know how to dumb it down, because it has to be explainable to a jury, and you have to remember your advantages. This is why it's incredible to me. When I look as a white-collar defense attorney, I have a nationwide practice, even though I'm based in D.C. I'm amazed at the lack of prosecutorial effort right now. It's not so much even the lack of indictments, though that is troubling, as the lack of even significant investigations. We don't hear anything about it. We hear about FCPA cases. There's plenty of those going around. We hear about insider trading cases. But there is nothing going on anywhere remotely like the SNL prosecutorial effort that we had in the early 1990s. So let's talk about being fearless. And in addition to needing line prosecutors who are fearless, you should be aware that the U.S. attorney's offices, historically and politically throughout the country, have a great deal of autonomy. You know, the U.S. attorneys are, the U.S. attorney in every district is appointed according to the Constitution by the president, but that is not what really happens. The U.S. attorney is really appointed by the senator or senators of the ruling party. And it is only in the absolute rarest instances when that does not happen. So for example, when Reagan was president and when Bush 1 was president, initially John Tower was the person appointing the U.S. attorneys in every district in Texas, and then it got to be Phil Graham. I think for some of that period, Lloyd Benson was still a senator, so he had nothing to do with it. If you don't have a senator from the president's party, different administrations have done it different ways. Sometimes they listen to the congressional delegation in their party, sometimes they'll listen to a governor, sometimes they'll say, in the Reagan administration, they tended to say, go away, we're gonna make the picks. And they do judges the same way. But the senators have even more power with respect to U.S. attorneys. And by the way, that's a problem in the Obama administration, because in reaction, and in my opinion, in an overreaction to the politicization that occurred under Attorney General Gonzales, they've been incredibly slow in appointing U.S. attorneys. And that's a different story in and of itself, which we can talk about offline. But the important point is there's great autonomy there. So if you get a good, strong U.S. attorney who himself or herself is fearless, you can do a lot there without interference from DOJ. Now, we have special problems here with the kind of prosecutions, or at least investigations, that a lot of folks want to see happening. That's at such a high level. Most of those cases would, many of those cases would originate in the Southern District in New York. And those institutions are of such significance when you talk about the major investment banks and the other banks, that there's obviously going to be DOJ input. Nobody is going to start an investigation. No U.S. attorney, in my opinion, is going to start an investigation of criminal investigation of Goldman Sachs or Bank of America without input and control from DOJ. But it's important to recognize that individual offices even now are starting to do some things. They're doing some things in the Eastern District of Virginia, which is traditionally a very aggressive district. You know, they've set up a securities fraud unit there. They've done some significant prosecutions. Getting back to the question of fearlessness, during the SNL, I told you I'm going to tell war stories. We really weren't afraid of anybody. The line prosecutors who were prosecuting this, we weren't afraid of anybody. It just really, and I don't know what it's like there now. I think most line prosecutors are the same way. I mean, if somebody tried the typical individual assistant United States attorney is there to be a do-gooder. You're there as a federal prosecutor because you represent the people of the United States and you want to get the bad guys. Now, most of them don't want to do white collar because it's difficult. They think it's difficult. That was the thing that surprised me during the FIREA era. That was what the Savings and Loan Reform Act was called. We've got Dodd-Frank. This was FIREA, and that's what got us all the money to get the prosecutors to do the investigations. But not a lot of people wanted to do it. And I was prosecuting in Raleigh, North Carolina, and I had tried to get a job in San Antonio. I'm from Texas, and they ended up, the first opening that they got, they gave it to some political hack. And so I thought, okay, well, I lost that opportunity. And then all of a sudden, FIREA slots came through, and I got a call, and they wanted me, because nobody else in San Antonio wanted to do it. We had the big Dallas Bank Fraud Task Force that had hundreds of FBI agents. More FBI agents in the Dallas Bank Fraud Task Force than I believe in the whole country are looking at financial institution fraud right now. They had a lot of resources. Houston and San Antonio didn't have as many resources. We would go to the meetings and hear about all the great things they were doing. We just had the normal resources of a U.S. Attorney's Office. There were only two of us in San Antonio regularly prosecuting SNL fraud. But we were having a blast and we loved doing it. But the typical prosecutor back in that time, and I think now, wants to do good, wants to be aggressive, wants to root out crime and find it. I think a lot more of them now are interested in white collar than used to be. Probably not as many as you think. And one of the reasons is one of the things you want, in addition to doing good, is you want glory. You know, there's some people who want to be prosecutors for life. There are other people that maybe want to do it for 5 or 10 years and do a big case and get to be famous and get a good reputation and go out and make some money in private practice because they've got kids and they're going to have to pay for a college education, and that's okay. We want to encourage people to go and get the glory, and as long as they're operating ethically. But the idea, and I think this is important because this is certainly the reasons why it isn't being investigated or prosecuted now, but it certainly isn't because, in my view, of any lack of courage by individual line prosecutors. The typical line prosecutor in the DOJ then and now, if you tried in any way to influence him, if somebody tried to come in and say, you're not going to do this case, I only had it even happen one time. I had a lawyer come in. I was investigating my first big SNL case, and one of the people I was looking at was a prominent partner in a law firm who had papered a lot of these dirty SNL deals. And he was a named partner in a big firm, and the other named partner came in and talked to me. And it was the crudest kind of effort I'd ever seen. And I didn't tell him anything, and which you're really not allowed to do. But I was polite, I met with him, and he had helped my boss, the U.S. attorney, get his job. And so it was a courtesy. I really didn't tell him anything, and he wasn't happy with that. He was kind of a George Steinbrenner type, you know, used to running everything. And he made some kind of a indication that he was going to maybe talk to my superiors, because he didn't like what I was saying. And I said, fine, you're free to do that. and I went and talked to my boss, and we immediately agreed that he should be recused from the case, the rest of the case, because this guy had helped him get, the job of U.S. attorney, and that was that. And that was, I was a federal prosecutor 12 years, and that's the only conversation I ever had like that. So that kind of conversation I don't think is going to happen, and if it does happen, it's only going to tick the prosecutor off more. The typical prosecutor is going to say, you're trying to influence me, you've just moved to the top of the line. So the problem isn't really with the individual prosecutor. You've got to be free of political influence. It's one of the, I'm not saying this is a partisan, because I am not a partisan, but generally speaking, one of the ironies, I don't think it happened, it's been happening in this latest crisis. I think there's been great inaction by the DOJ, both under the Republican regime and under the current Democratic regime, when you look at financial institution fraud. With respect to the Republicans, the vast nature of it, you know, obviously didn't become clear until 2008. So you really can't make, you know, the same kind of judgment you can make after it all is coming to light. You can make harsher judgment against the Democrats. I think it's one of the great ironies that, by and large, in the last 30 or 40 years, within the DOJ, there's less political influence when in investigations when Republicans are running things than when Democrats are running things. And the reason for this, I think, is that Republicans who are involved in DOJ, obviously, Alberto Gonzalez is an exception, but Republicans who are running DOJ, when there is financial institution fraud, they're so scared of being accused of going soft on business that once a scandal really comes to light and it's clear that there is a crime, they kind of stay out of your way. And I'm telling you that in the SNL crisis, there was absolutely no political influence. Nobody ever told me. We were going after the biggest SNLs in the country that had failed. Nobody ever. Now, there was a lot of that going on when Bill Black was looking at things a few years before for the Federal Home Loan Bank. But once everybody realized these banks have failed and there was criminality, you see nothing like the rear guard actions you're seeing now. There was total support. President Bush gave a speech to DOJ officials, the attorney generals at the time, Thornburg and Barr. It was full speed ahead. We're going to get these people who committed these crimes. Nobody told us not to work on a case. An example, this isn't explicitly a one of these examples is a savings and loan, and one is not. During the course of examining the savings and loan frauds in Texas, and remember, you really don't start ginning up the cases until about, you know, the scandal hits, I don't know, you've got the Southwest plan was 87 or something like that, and then the scandal comes to light, everybody really knows it's criminal by 89, we start ginning up the cases, and you really start prosecuting the stuff in the early 1990s. And I happen to find that an incredibly prominent person in San Antonio is implicated in one of these deals. Not a particularly big deal, but we're looking at a pretty minor savings and loan fraud, lender fraud, and we get one of the guys that we're looking at coming to us saying, well, Mr. Big, we'll call him Mr. Big. I mean, he would be like the Joe Paterno of San Antonio at the time. And he's involved. He knew I was committing this crime. And so we put him into the system. We put this person into the system. You know, the FBI knows he's being investigated. It goes into a system. President Bush, remember, was doing the 1,000 points of light, okay? And he was going to have a 1,000 points of light ceremony, and Mr. Big was scheduled to be there as a recipient or as a bigwig. And so word came down, just a word. You know, is that investigation still active? You know, if it is, fine. We won't even invite him. We don't even want to invite him to this ceremony. If it isn't, we'd like to be able to invite him. And basically I said, you know, tell him it is, back off, leave me alone. And that was it, you know. So another example, this is not a savings and loan example. You know, Ed Meese took a lot of flack when he was Attorney General for some of the comments he made, and I think for some of the, you know, couple of loans he got before he was Attorney General. There were investigations. He was never charged with anything. But he was a great prosecutor as Attorney General. And there was a case in West Virginia where somebody was looking at the Republican governor. An AUSA was looking at the Republican governor, investigating the Republican governor, and her boss, one of her bosses, basically told her, you're not going to investigate that case anymore. And she complained to DOJ, and Meese's assistant at the time, Artie Burns, you know, they came in, they told the person who had told her to back off, you're out of the case, get out, don't say a word. They completely protected the line prosecutors. So you've got to have a situation if you're going to prosecute this. You absolutely have to have a situation.
Go ahead. I just want to finish. Yeah. Question relative.
Okay.
Finish your thought.
Yeah. You've got to have a situation where you're free of political influence. You don't want to be worrying about, you know, getting the wrong person mad. Yes, sir.
Is the protocol in each U.S. Attorney's office the same? I mean, is there a national protocol for decision-making on prosecution, or does it vary by office?
It varies by office. Now, there's a lot more micromanagement from Washington than there used to be. But again, like I say, there's a lot of autonomy. You know, if you look at an organizational chart within DOJ, an AUSA doesn't have many reports. An AUSA, in fact, I don't even think, it may be a direct reporting line to one official other than the AG. Now the way it works in effect is there's an associate attorney general, the number three position. Either the number, depending on who's the AG, either the number three or number two position in DOJ, that's where the reporting gets done. But there's a tremendous amount of autonomy. It depends on the office. Back in the SNL era, people actually wanted to investigate this stuff. So, I mean, you had tons of referrals coming in, and you weren't gonna even get to all of them, because we didn't have the task force like Dallas did, so we got to pick the best ones, you know, and you went after them. And so literally, you got a report on your desk from either the Resolution Trust Corporation or the Office of Thrift Supervision or the FBI. And it was, if you were a prosecutor that wanted to get crooks, get SNL crooks, it was just great. And obviously, you had the best cases, you got the best referrals. And you did it. And I had been a prosecutor for only a year and a half in Raleigh. And I had not done any sophisticated, I'd done some white collar, but nothing like savings and loan fraud. And the first case I did when I came, I got an RTC, so I didn't really have a lot of experience. I got an RTC referral, and it laid out a case, and it was beautiful. It was clear that this was a fraud involving an outside borrower who had done a bunch of straw deals. And I really didn't know a lot. If I'd known more, I probably would not have prosecuted the case. But you know, I just said, this is a great report. It's very clear what happened. Let's just indict it, okay? And there's no question it met the standards. There was probable cause that a crime had been committed, but I didn't have the agent go out and interview any of the straw purchasers. You know, typically you would go and interview a straw purchaser and get the straw purchaser to admit, yeah, the borrower told me he's just using my name and I'm never gonna have to repay the loan. Well, you've got your crime then, okay, if you do that. But I didn't even do that. I just said, well, you know, look, it's a crime. Let's indict him. We interviewed the people afterwards. It, you know, it worked, but I mean, sorry, go ahead.
I have a question.
Sure.
Do you think, take this as a compliment, that perhaps the Department of Justice is afraid of high-powered attorneys like yourself, think that they're likely to lose if they bring prosecution in certain cases, and that they're over-relying on deferred prosecution agreements and those kinds of things as a crutch to avoid going through full prosecutions, so that while there may be political influence and those kinds of things coming into play, you've got, you know, high-powered defense lawyers like yourself that will spend any amount of money to defend the big corporate clients, and that's why they may be going more to the DPAs and those kinds of things.
I've got a two-part answer to your question. Are there individual prosecutors who may be afraid in certain districts of that high-powered representation or of losing? Yep, maybe. The department as a whole, I can't believe that that's why they're not doing it. There have to be other reasons. There have to be political reasons. That's foreign to my experience. Yes, ma'am.
Well, also, I was a federal prosecutor for over 10 years, and it's a symbiotic relationship with the defense counsel in town, and you have the experience. And you thrive on prosecutions as a defense counsel, the same with me now.
How you get business.
You want to see these cases being brought so you have some business. And plus, I did RTC work as well as you did.
Uh-huh.
And we don't have anything akin to that now.
You don't have any referrals?
There's no civil prosecution. Yeah. There's no criminal prosecution. And they're long time and expensive. And you also have the mindset of, unfortunately, President Obama, that he wants to have a reconciliation commission like they did in South Africa.
Right.
You know, let's all make nice with each other.
I think prosecutions are better than reconciliation commissions. I think they concentrate the mind.
Absolutely.
And they act as a good deterrent. And I don't think people who are, but look, at least you got to have investigations when there appears to be massive fraud that's the cause of something. Did I answer your question, though? Basically, it's different in each jurisdiction. You have great differences of level of sophistication. You've got small districts where I'm sure they still say, we can't prosecute X. X is the major employer in the district. And remember, you don't have to prosecute the entity. You can prosecute the people who were running the entity. If you're worrying about putting people out of work, you can prosecute the person who's the corrupt CEO. Yep.
A follow-up question.
Sure.
Do you anticipate any real uptick in either SEC action and then maybe DOJ action after that with the Dodd-Frank whistleblower regulations, which allow 10-30% of an SEC recovery for certain kinds of...
I think you'll see a lot of stuff come out of whistleblower, because that's a monetary incident, of
right.
Dodd-Frank whistleblower. So I'm hopeful in that regard. And some of it may cause DOJ to take action. I hope it does, at least to investigate. I mean, I think just looking at prosecutors are like anybody else. They'd rather have it handed to them on a silver platter. I think one way to do those cases is to look at all these civil cases that are being filed that Christopher talked about. Look at the civil cases and if you've got a fraud allegation, why wouldn't you do that? Why wouldn't you look at the civil cases being filed and say, or the SEC cases, if you're in a particular district, doesn't have to be the biggest fraud in the world, and say, that looks like a fraud. We should be investigating that. I don't understand why.
And put them in jail. Forget about.
Well, there's no question that if they're convicted under the sentencing guidelines, they're going to prison, and they're going to prison for a long time. And I imagine that's behind some of the whatever lobbying's going on that has kept the prosecutive effort from going forward. And again, I'm not saying a prosecution should be initiated unless the standards are met. And the standards are, you have probable cause to believe a crime is committed, and you actually, as the prosecutor, have to believe that a rational jury would convict. So, but we're not even seeing the investigations that we should be seeing. And that is what is so troubling. As a citizen, it's what's troubling. Resources, you have to have sufficient resources. We've already touched on the fact, and Professor Black has many times, that we had phenomenal resources. They passed FIREA. I had two auditors working with me, one of them a CPA, full-time the whole time I was doing FIREA prosecutions. We had the Financial Fraud Task Force, DOJ-wide. We had the Dallas Task Force, which, as I mentioned, more FBI agents there than in the country right now are investigating financial institution fraud. We had the words of encouragement from the president. We had words of encouragement and carrot and the stick, what are you doing? What are your stats? From Attorney General, from Thornburg, from Barr, from Reno. Awards were given, really high awards within DOJ. Cash awards and awards of recognition for successful prosecutions. It was seen as a crisis for which people should be held accountable. Again, if you don't have the resources, you improvise. My first big savings and loan case was Victoria Savings and Loan. It was one of the top 100 failures. It was $40 million, which back then was considered a lot of money. $40 million in losses, and I was assigned an FBI agent who is a good friend of mine, and he had done. He's a great agent. He's retired now, and he had done bank robberies his whole life. And the big complaint back then was a lot of the FBI agents don't like to look at paper, and you know. But he recognized. In fact, you know, I like to say one of the reasons the FBI is my favorite, and I was known as the FBI's whore when I was an assistant U.S. attorney. I loved working with the Bureau, and one reason was, and this agent was not dumb at all, but as I used to say, even the dumbest FBI agent knows how to handle evidence and to do a chain of custody, which is actually incredibly important in a financial institution fraud case. The first one I did was Secret Service. They had absolutely no concept of what chain of custody was. But this, you know, there was one particular piece of evidence we had subpoenaed from a title company in a savings and loan fraud, and I hadn't seen it, you know, and I thought that they were resisting our subpoena. I didn't like this title company, and I had somebody call up one of the FIREA auditors, call them up and yell at them, and I said, call them up and yell at them and threaten them. They're 3 weeks past their subpoena, and they said they've already given it to the FBI. And I talked to the agent. I said, where's the paperwork? I need to look at the paperwork. Well, that's in the bulky room. That's where they kept the evidence. You can't look at that. That's in the bulky room. So, I mean, this was a particular agent who had no, he wanted to help on the case. He just didn't, he hadn't done white collar work and didn't want to look at paperwork. So he came up with a solution was, we've got the resources, let's get an agent who does do financial fraud to help me, and I'll be the enforcer. So Bob, who was the main case agent, brought in Jim Key, who's a great, you know, he had already done some SNL fraud cases in San Francisco. He was a guy who knew how to do it, and our auditors knew how to gather the stuff and tell me why it was significant. And Bob, you know, Bob, the case agent, the main case agent, ended up being the enforcer. You know, he looked like Bob Newhart. You know, he looked like the most mild-mannered person in the world, but when he went out to serve a subpoena or the interview a witness, he was incredibly intimidating. I don't exactly know why, but he loved being an FBI agent. His dad was an FBI agent, and he'd come and say, you know, I'm Bob with the FBI. You'd call everybody by their first name, no matter how powerful they were. You know, Helen, you're going to cooperate with me. You have this subpoena. Don't make me come and get you. I mean, it was like central casting, and it was great. So you work with what you've got, and it becomes fun. All right, you have to be willing to lose, okay? You have to be willing to send a signal. I mean, if a case is righteous, and this is my answer to your question, I think there are far too many prosecutors, particularly, interestingly enough, in these big districts where there's a symbiotic, there's a revolving door between, you see this much more in the civil side. I don't think in general you have a problem that you have sometimes in the SEC and the other regulatory agencies of, my God, I want to get a big job and I'm going to have to play ball if I don't play ball, I may not get a great job in the private sector. And this guy who's negotiating with me is my buddy. He used to work here, and I'm going to be nice to him. That doesn't happen across the board in the SEC, but it clearly happens. It happened in Sir Alan Stanford, with the attorney who's now with the Dallas firm and who got criticized in the IG's report. I can't remember his name. Okay, that by and large does not happen in U.S. attorney's offices, in my view. The danger is, a particular prosecutor in one of the big districts may feel like, if I do this case and lose it, I'm only going to be employable if I have a big case and win it. If I lose it, I'm the guy who lost the big case and I'm not going to get hired. So I think that is creeping in some of the, and oddly enough, in some of the big offices where it should not. It's important to send a signal. There has to be a real crime there, and you have to think that a reasonable jury will convict the person. But beyond that, you can't not go in there because you think, oh my God, I might lose. I mean, you know, that's part of the risk of the job, and that's part of the fun of the job. And one of the things about, is it Preet Bharara, I think is how you pronounce it, the U.S. attorney in the Southern District right now. This is slightly off topic, but I've kind of made fun of him in some posts I've done for the White Collar Crime Prof blog, which they let me post on occasionally, because I don't think insider trading is a big deal, okay? I think that they're prosecuting, DOJ is prosecuting Foreign Corrupt Practices Act and insider trading like crazy. I get it, Congress passed the law, there are people who think that's bad, it is a crime for the most part, people know it's a crime. So I understand if you want to prosecute it, if you want to make that decision to prosecute it, prosecute it. But they're prosecuting that stuff like crazy and ignoring the financial meltdown. But, let me finish my thought if you don't mind. But I do think that it is important that Preet is sending a signal. It's obvious there's a culture of lawlessness on Wall Street, and there has been, you know, for the last 10 years. And so, and by the way, it's not like they never prosecuted insider trading. They've been consistently finding it and prosecuting it, and most people have been pleading guilty to it for a long time. But he upped it up, he's increased it, and he's done Title III wires, which is unheard of. And he's sending a signal that there's rampant lawlessness here. Everybody knows about insider trading, and you still violate it, and I'm going to go after it, and I'm going to stop it. So that sends a signal. That's great. So you got to send a signal, and the signal is, we think there's a crime, and we're going to prosecute it, and if we lose, we lose. That's part of the job. You're not going to win them all. That's okay. Let God sort them out, is what we used to say. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I'm sure what you're going to say is because those are easy prosecutions.
They are.
They don't take a lot of time or effort.
I thought it was hilarious that you had all these articles in the journal. I understand he's a big shot, so it's a big case and they're tapes. So you had all these articles in the journal, but they were all saying, you know, oh, it's going to be a tough case. And it wasn't a tough case. Those prosecutors should have moved to Brazil if they lost that case. I mean, that's one of the easiest cases of all time. And I did this thing where I said, Dowd's in the catbird seat. You know, no one in the defense bar expects him to win. So if he loses, big deal. His reputation isn't hurt. And if he wins, he's a genius. And I think the rumor in the defense bar is that the initial retainer is $20 million on that case. So, I mean, you know, that's so you got to be willing to lose. Doesn't mean you're reckless. Doesn't mean you're a do-gooder. You have to believe a rational jury will convict. Too many prosecutors are afraid to lose. I'll give you an example again. I'll give an example about sending a signal and being fearless. When Patrick Fitzgerald, who I am less enamored of after he gave his infamous press conference when Blagojevich was indicted, but I supported him a lot, said a lot of things in his favor during the Scooter Libby investigation in that case. And one of the things he did, he was already feared. He already had a great reputation when he came to Washington to be independent counsel. He was special counsel. They had gotten rid of the statute by then. So people already knew his reputation because he had been a prosecutor in the EDBA. He had been in the Southern, I think, he'd been in the Southern District of New York. He was a known quantity. And now he was U.S. attorney in Chicago, of course, and he's assigned to do it. But Washington will eat you up and cut you up even if you're very, very respected, as I learned has happened to my former boss, Ken Starr. And one of the things that he did, that Fitzgerald did, early on, through indicting Libby, which was relatively early in the investigation, is to send a signal. And that signal is, don't screw with this investigation. If we subpoena you and you come to the grand jury, you can take the fifth. Not many political actors want to take the fifth, because if it ever comes out, they're dead. You know, they'll never work for any administration again. So you can take the Fifth Amendment, or you can come in and testify, but if you testify and lie to us, you are going to be indicted for perjury. That's a tremendously important thing because that sent a signal. And whether or not he would have won or lost on Scooter Libby, that sent a signal. And don't think that that did not affect the investigation, as did his decision to go all the way on reporter's privilege. But particularly important was that indictment. So that's an important function that you need in this kind of a situation. Winning ugly. That's one of the best ways. That's really important. You know, a lot of these guys, it's mostly guys who do this, who commit these crimes. But a lot of them, you can't always get them on the main thing that they did. It's too hard. So you got to do an Al Capone theory. You know, you've got to get them You got to get the murderer on the tax evasion. So, again, I'll give you an example from the SNL era. We had a guy, I'll just say his first name. His first name is Matt. He's not with us anymore. And he was known. He was just well known. He was an outside borrower. He was a developer. And there's an area north of San Antonio called Marble Falls. And he was just, everybody talked about what a fraudster he was. And how, and why wasn't he indicted for what he did up in the development in Marble Falls. And he did it all, from lying on the loans to ripping chandeliers out of houses before he let him go. And for some reason that I couldn't figure out, I didn't have that case, for some reason he was never indicted for that. We found, this is that first case I told you about, we found that he was doing straw loans. He had houses that he had bridge loans on. They were about to all come due. He couldn't get them sold because the market had gone down. And so he had a bunch of his employees and his dentist act as straw purchasers. It was a really little deal. It was not a big deal. Okay? And I later heard him that he was complaining. Why are they getting me for this? I've done all this stuff. Why are they getting me for this? Okay? This is nothing compared to what I've done. And so I call that winning ugly. I did something that I'm not overwhelmingly proud of. You've got to always be ethical, of course. I had a major savings and loan case, very big one, and we're getting close to trial. And you've got to send your 404B notice to the defendant. And one of the senior officers of this institution, one of the things he had done was he had taken money from the institution because his daughter, who worked for a local real estate company, had taken $10,000 and couldn't account for it. And they were going to go report her to the police. And he just took $10,000 from the institution and paid it back and did some kind of phony paperwork for it. Now, I hadn't charged him with that because we didn't know about it at the time. Probably the indictment was broad enough to cover it. So you send your 404B, everybody know 404B is bad acts, other bad acts that we're going to be allowed to talk about at your trial. And I sent him, and I had a long list, and one of them was, I put his daughter's name down, and I put your use of $10,000 from the bank to pay for your daughter's embezzlement. Okay? And a week later, he pled guilty. All right, and I believe he wouldn't have pled guilty if he hadn't have gotten that. He hadn't gotten that 404B. He had a complete right to do it. Complete right to put it in as evidence. So you got to be willing to, as long as you're acting ethically.
So why do you feel bad about it?
Well, you know, I just do. I do, you know. And you know, we've got that. We've got making Monica's mom testify at the grand jury. No, I don't think it was wrong. I don't think it was wrong to call her to the grand jury. I don't know. I just, for whatever it's worth, they're certainly totally proper. Nobody could file a complaint, with DOJ because I did it. And so we did it. There's another case where it was an institution with widespread fraud, but they were much more intelligent than some of the other institutions. It was not as easy to find. Most of them were fish in a barrel. But they had a series of loans where, this really relates to dumbing it down. They had a series of loans where they had phony liens. It was flipping. People were flipping houses back then. And they created phony liens. And the primary reason they created the phony liens was, you know, there's always the last guy that the house gets sold to when they're flipping houses. And what is it? You never know who's swimming naked till the tide runs out, okay? So ultimately the market crashes and the last poor schlemiel who gets sold the property is left in a bind. And so one of the reasons, so they're selling these, they're flipping these properties and selling them at inflated prices. And even if they're selling them and giving non-recourse loans, they still want to hide stuff. And the primary reason they put, they slapped on these phony liens was to make the ultimate buyer feel like the house is really worth more than it is, or the property is really worth more than it is. These were major developments that were being sold, major pieces of parcels of land. But anyway, we found them. We found a series of deals where, house
how
gets...
How were they found?
Pardon?
How were they found?
We found them, there's a loan analysis that's done by OTS or RTC. And I can't remember exactly how they found them. I mean, you can, if it's all done the same day, I think they found that one because of an internal memo in one of the major outside borrower's files that they should have destroyed. In fact, they argued to the jury, if we were that bad, we would have destroyed this. And I had to end up saying, well, they're not, crooks aren't always smart, look at Rosemary Woods in the 18 and a half minute gap or whatever it was. And they had an internal memo, the outside borrower, that said, here are the closing statements. Cheryl, you're going to get the closing statements on this deal. The settlement statements do not reflect what actually occurred. So that was extremely helpful. Okay, and that's really how we found out, how somebody found out. But that's incredible. Really, and one of the defendant's main lawyer came up to the FBI agent and said, you wouldn't have a case without those phony liens. And he said, yeah, but we got the liens. But they were a small part of the overall fraud and losses at the institution, but there they were, and you got to tell a jury, that's really all that there is to say on Dumb It Down. You got to be able to show a jury they lie, cheat, and they steal. Okay, here it is. They lied on a settlement statement. And it's not a very good defense to say, yeah, we lied, but we were only trying to defraud the end borrower. We weren't really trying to defraud the bank. Yes, sir.
How did you, you mentioned the examiners and the courts. How were your relations and how much support did you get from the FDIC and RTC staff? Were you upset at all, or did you like it, or did you use it, the parallel proceedings the FDIC and the RTC were bringing with their outside counsel for recoveries?
The only time I got along great. The only time I didn't get along was when I moved to stay an outside parallel proceeding and enraged an FDIC lawyer because he wanted to do his case, and I was in the way. The prosecutor usually always wants to stay the civil case because he fears, or she fears, something can go wrong. And also, the civil case, you may end up, the defendant may end up getting stuff in discovery that you're not ready to give him yet. Okay, it's the thing I complain about now on the defense side.
And what about your reaction towards requests from the FDIC to include counts for restitution?
We didn't have a problem with that, though back then that was a newer concept. But
yeah, we were trying to get people to start doing it.
Yeah.
From our end, we thought we were getting a lot of resistance from the prosecutor.
I think you probably were, and probably because, and now of course it's automatic. Prosecutors.
Yes, it should have been.
And they have no choice. The prosecutor has to put in restitution and forfeiture. But it was just like, no, wait a second, I want to get the bad guys. This is complicated. I don't want to do that. And that was kind of meant. That was kind of the reaction back.
So they had no concept that it was, from our standpoint, a lot of them didn't have any concept that it was just as important to get the money back, and a lot of people would go to prison as long as they got to keep their millions. What do they care?
Right. Well, in general, as far as I remember, I'm biased, I think I got along well with people, and in fact, in our case, here's a problem I had. I'm glad you reminded me of this. In Victoria Savings' case, there was a defendant named Ed Barron. And he had actually come in early and pled early, and if he had really cooperated, would have gotten a phenomenal deal. And remember, back then, the prison sentences weren't that high. He had a couple of problems, and we didn't find out one of them until the case was over. He was hiding money in the Cayman Islands, and so that was one that was one problem. But the other thing was, there was so much turnover with the FDIC attorneys. Maybe it was the FISLIC, I can't remember at this point. But the civil attorney I was dealing with, there was so much turnover. Well, FISLIC was gone, so it had to be FDIC. But the problem was that he had negotiated, they out-negotiated me in the plea agreement. in this sense. They had a thing in there that said, whatever restitution you get, he has to pay to the FDIC will be the restitution in the criminal case. Okay? And so there was so much turnover in the FDIC attorneys, I had to keep calling and emailing. Well, I don't know, we didn't have email back then. I had to keep calling him and saying, because they were always, he was going to the FDIC and saying, you need to settle with me, I don't have any money. And I was saying, he's got money. I know he's got money. And by the way, if you settle with him, you know, they were thinking, no, the criminal can always get anything we don't have. And I had to call him and say, no, I screwed up. Whatever you make him do is all he's going to pay. And I had to say that to five or six different attorneys. And there were a couple of times when he was very close to settling, you know, for pennies on the dollar, and we wouldn't have gotten any money from him. Then we found out the money in the Caymans, and then he was toast.
But the way he got the money in the Caymans is in the settlement agreement, and it had a provision that anything you did not declare on your asset statement is automatically forfeited to the United States. And of course, they didn't declare the $4 million in the Caymans. And that's how we got
Well, actually, money. How it actually was found in the case of Victoria, this is Victoria Savings, was after the trial was over and the newspaper story came out, the secretary of the two main SNL officers, after they got kicked out of the SNL by FDIC, they went and just set up their own business. And that's when they hid their money in the Caymans. And their secretary at the time, she had no connection with the bank. She read the story about the case after the convictions. And maybe even after the day he was sentenced, she read the story and she called up the FBI and said, I've got something to tell you. And that's how they found out.
That's how it happens.
I had a good experience. Now they work, civil and criminal generally work very well together. I mean, if you're doing a securities fraud case, SEC and DOJ are working hand in hand from the beginning, for the overwhelming majority of cases. So if you go and say anything to the SEC, it's going straight to DOJ. That's why if you represent a subject or a target, you're not going to talk to the SEC. You're going to invoke the Fifth Amendment. That's why as interesting as what Judge Rakoff is trying to do in the Southern District, when he said the other day, why are they saying you don't admit or deny? Well, if you make an individual, no individual is ever going to settle with the SEC if he admits or she admits wrongdoing, unless he's got a separate agreement with the DOJ that you're not going to be prosecuted. You're a fool. You've just admitted guilt. And a corporation is going to be admitting it for purposes of civil suit. So you won't have any settlements. You just won't have any settlements. And that's the problem. Every case will go to trial. Winning ugly. The other thing about winning ugly, which is also goes into willing to lose, is you have a lot of cases. You're going to have them now, and you certainly had them in the SNL era, when a person's going to have an attorney reliance defense. Well, that's a problem. You get a really good jury instruction if you have an attorney reliance defense. So what do? You either decide not to indict if you think it's a legitimate defense. I mean, our position was, wait a second, some frauds are so obvious that no attorney reliance defense is valid. No attorney can tell you it's okay to lie, cheat, and steal. That was my attitude as a prosecutor. Okay, so how do you deal with that in reality? You either go to the attorney and determine that the attorney really wasn't told everything, all right? Because, you know, the way the attorney reliance jury instruction is, if the attorney's not, the attorney has to be told everything. And most attorneys are more than willing to give up the client and to say, oh, he didn't tell me that. If I had known that, I never would have told him it was okay. But occasionally you will have an attorney who will not do that. And so then you're either in a situation where you've got to be confident that you can tell the jury, this I don't care what his attorney said, it was a fraud, it's obviously a fraud, or you've got to indict the attorney. You've got to be willing to indict an attorney. And let me tell you, back in this era, in the savings and loan era, personally, I had a really good success rate, except in indicting attorneys, in convicting attorneys. And generally speaking, I found that juries even though they had an incredibly low opinion of attorneys, have trouble convicting attorneys if the attorney did not make anything more than his or her typical professional fee. So in Victoria Savings, we indicted an attorney who blessed these deals I was telling you about that had phony liens, and totally blessed them, and we indicted him, and my theory was he's an attorney. He, of all people, should know. He blessed it. It's fraud on its face, and he was acquitted.
And what was his defense?
His defense was, I'm busy. I'm a busy attorney, and I just didn't, I didn't really look into it closely. And actually, it's a pretty, it's not an awful defense. I do X amount of property work per week, and I just didn't. Sure wish it's kind of Joe Paterno type. I wish I had done more. I wish I had done more. And you bring in, and this was a good guy, and he came to the grand jury, which is not a wise thing to do. I won't let anyone go to the grand jury who's a target or a subject, any client, unless they sign a thing saying, my attorney has advised me this is the stupidest thing to do in the world. He went and told the story to the grand jury, testified at trial, and told the same story, and was very credible. And all we really had on him was that he had knowledge and he had approved this paperwork, and the jury acquitted him. And there was an inside counsel at Victoria Savings who we indicted, and who had state judges come as character witnesses. The outside attorney did too, and he was acquitted as well. He was acquitted, and I believe he was the person who cut up his indictment into 1,000 little pieces and sent it to me, FedEx, after he was acquitted. And the jury acquitted him, and made sure he got acquitted before Thanksgiving. Then they deliberated another couple of weeks before they convicted most of the other defendants, except for that lawyer I mentioned.
Don't you think, in your experience, that most common, I know most of the common that I prosecuted were all very charming, wonderful human beings, ostensibly, to the jury. They were very good con artists.
Oh, to the jury?
Yes.
Well, most of the people I indicted didn't take the stand. They decided not to take the stand. This attorney was very credible on the stand, and he just said, I didn't pay enough attention. I should have paid more attention to it. I didn't have any intent to defraud. And it's just funny, in my view, juries kind of have a duty. Well, that's why you have a lawyer there. A lawyer is, it's an odd thing, because people don't really have a lot of respect for lawyers, by and large, if you look at opinion polls and things like that. But there's a feeling that, I thought it was a very successful argument. Obviously, it was successful. All he made was his little fee. I mean, they showed he didn't get a part of the deal. If he gets a part of the deal, he's dead meat, okay? But he didn't. And the odd thing is I told you about that we found out that Ed Barron had was hiding $2 million in the Caymans after the case. He was one of the senior officers. And his testimony was pretty good. He was the first one to come and plead. His testimony was pretty good at trial. But the one guy his testimony wasn't that good about was this inside lawyer who got acquitted. And I was furious, about it. I thought he had crawfished on me, as we say in the South. And so it later turned out that this inside lawyer had complete knowledge of the Cayman Islands money, which, remember, we didn't know at the time, and had arranged all the shell corporations to hide the money in the Cayman. So that's why Ed Barron wasn't saying anything bad about him. So after he had cut his indictment up into little pieces and sent them to me, a few months later when we figured out he had been involved, the FBI went and visited him. And it was like, he thought he was going to be indicted. We didn't. And it was like, the game is up. But that's a big deal. Attorney reliance, everybody tries to get attorney reliance. You think these people, if they start indicting the SNL, the financial, you think Lloyd... I don't want to name any names. Do you think those people don't have tons of lawyers who are going to say, they're going to say attorney reliance? They will. So you got to be willing to deal with that. I think that's about it. So I would just say that I think I've talked about dumbing it down. You gotta make it as dumb as you can. I mean, as simple as you can. It's lying, cheating, and stealing. And if you can't explain that to a jury, and you can do that with accounting fraud, you can have someone explain how cooking the books, why it's wrong. It can be done. You've got to be able to do that to win these cases. You need your experts, but you've got to be able to. I don't mean that as disrespect to the jury. I used to tell the I couldn't balance my checkbook when I became a FIREA prosecutor. And I couldn't now. I don't have to now because, you know, you have online. You can just look every day. And oh, I'm being told to stop. I'm done. Questions? I know how to follow directions. Sure.
As citizens, what can we do to encourage that these prosecutions happen?
Really not much that I can see. I know it's obviously a decision being made at the highest levels that we don't. Somebody mentioned that President Obama wants to have a truth commission instead of investigating and prosecuting. If the will is there, and it was there in the savings and loan crisis, and it was really President Bush who set the tone, and whoever was Attorney General at the time, Thornburg and then Barr, you've got to have it at the top. It's got to be. I mean, I think there are people here who may know more than I do about why it's not happening. I'm just telling you, it's not even being investigated. Okay.
That's why they don't want a truth commission, quite the opposite. They want immunity that'll shut down investigations so that the facts never come out. And the whole idea of the truth commission is to bring the facts out.
What kind of immunity? Who wants immunity? I can understand that the people who'd be investigating.
The largest banks, according to all the New York Times stories, are trying to negotiate an immunity agreement off of the using as a device.
The RoboCop?
The RoboCop.
Oh, that's another thing. I mean, look, the AUSA, the bad side of being an AUSA kind of is that you're like, sometimes you feel like a collection agency for the banks. I mean, really, you know, what's the first thing a bank does when a loan goes bad? The first thing they do is look in the loan file and let's see if we can find a lie. And then we're going to send it to the U.S. Attorney's Office and they can prosecute it. You're a friggin' bank collection prosecutor. That's what you feel like sometimes, okay? So here you've got this deal. You've got RoboCop, where you've got the mortgage companies and the banks, presumably, you know, you've got an absolute outright fraud. There's yet to be one indictment, right?
Correct.
I'm sorry, that's an outrage. That is an absolute dereliction of duty. And I don't want to hear that we can't do that because we want the market to bottom out. That's ridiculous. You can prosecute a case, you can take a file. You can say you're going to wait on this particular case, okay? That's an outrage, all right? That's a political decision to prosecute A or B or not to prosecute A or B. That's an outrage. I mean, for years we've done these chicken bleep cases against an individual borrower who lied. Yeah, they lied, okay? And they're indicting hundreds of people who are involved in mortgage fraud, and they should be. But they're pikers, okay? They're class C fraudsters. They need to be indicted. But those stats are meaningless. And the fact that you won't indict this, yes, it's relatively small scale. Maybe you disagree, but it clearly is outrageous that to get people out of their help, get people out of their homes. Think about that. That's a slam dunk in front of a jury. You're trying to get somebody out of his house or her house. And you dummy up papers. Not one indictment. It's an outrage.
100,000 times a year.
What civil remedies are available in that instance?
In the
robo signing or the.
I don't know. I don't know offhand. I just don't do civil work.
They're not particularly good for the individual plaintiff type thing because your losses are so tiny. And class action, well, you've seen what's being done to class actions. So the by far the better actions are by the HUDs and FHAs and such, and they're not bringing those actions, or they bring them and then they stop them. By the way, there's also no real investigation, right?
Oh, really?
The theory of this is that there's a state AG investigation, but the states don't have the resources.
They don't have the power or the resources to do it like it should be done. So there's no federal investigation even of it?
No, there's no federal investigation.
You're sure about that? Well, that's pathetic. That's just pathetic.
I'm sure there's something called an investigation.
Yeah, right, right. I mean, and I want to say one thing, because I'm writing down some statements, and it is important to keep this in mind. From last night, from Mr. Angelides, is that how you pronounce it? And some things you said, Bill, earlier today. It happened in front of us. It was allowed to occur. There's a widespread failure to regulate. The system was rife with fraud. Something called a liar's loan throughout the industry. All of those actually make it, it's not a cakewalk. All those actually make it harder to prosecute. One of the really hard things, and this gets into kind of future ways to deal with this, one of the really hard things about these cases to prosecute is you're a prosecutor and you're starting to get there and you say, they lied. They lied to the examiners. That's awful. We got them. And then you find out the examiner found out they lied to him and he didn't do anything about it. That kind of makes it harder to do so. That is a problem. And in terms of future, and the SEC may say this is being done, I don't know, but in terms of, you've got this difference between the regulatory mind and they may have the cane now, the regulatory mind and the prosecutor's mind. They're very different, right? The regulator, Bernie Madoff, lies to him and tells him he's not an investment advisor, and they don't do anything. They don't even send a referral out. And I think one of the ways you deal with this is you have a rule, and the SEC may have this now, where you just have this new mindset in any regulatory agency. If anybody I'm regulating lies to me, I have no choice in the matter. It's an immediate emergency referral to some kind of prosecutive authority. Anytime, I don't know how realistic that is.
No, it's completely, that was our rule.
Anytime I'm lied to when I'm examining somebody, that shoots up a separate ladder.
That's what
and I don't know if they're doing it now, but I can tell you they may be doing it again with the Pikers, but they're not doing it in any other way. Thanks. Sorry I went over.